In the previous video, we talked about how an uncompetitive inhibitor will interact with the enzyme-substrate complex to form this enzyme-substrate inhibitor complex, which ultimately prevents the production of products. In this case, the presence of an inhibitor will actually draw our KM equilibrium towards the enzyme-substrate complex, meaning that we observe a higher affinity, and when we have a higher affinity, we have a smaller KM. So when there is an uncompetitive inhibitor present, we see a smaller KM value than if we were to do this reaction without an inhibitor. In terms of the Vmax, because of the presence of our enzyme-substrate inhibitor complex, it is never possible for the total enzyme concentration to equal the concentration of the enzyme-substrate complex. Because no matter what we do, some of this enzyme-substrate complex will shift towards this inhibited complex. So this statement will never be true. Consequently, our Vmax value will also be lower when we have an uncompetitive inhibitor present. Okay, let's look and see how this influences our Michaelis-Menten plot. So what we're looking at here is the red line is our graph without inhibitor present. And the green line here represents an experiment that's done in the presence of an uncompetitive inhibitor. What we really notice here is that this line with the inhibitor is never going to approach the same Vmax as without inhibitor. So we have a decreased Vmax, right? So our Vmax here for the absence of inhibitor, let's say, is up around 250, but in the presence of an inhibitor, we're down at around 125. So we have a smaller Vmax. When we think about our KM value, right? So with the inhibitor around, here's Vmax over 2. So our KM value is right around about 7.5. So KM without an inhibitor is 7.5, but in the presence of an inhibitor, right, so we're now down here at our Vmax over 2, and this value comes significantly lower. So our KM for the reaction with the uncompetitive inhibitor is 5, so it's smaller. So what we see here is both KM and Vmax are smaller, and that's what we expect for an uncompetitive inhibitor. The presence of this inhibitor will also influence our Lineweaver-Burk plot. Remember our Lineweaver-Burk plot, we're plotting the inverse of our initial velocity versus the inverse of our substrate concentration. And in this case, what we see is, again, the green line is with the inhibitor, and the red line is without the inhibitor. Okay. What we notice here right away is that the slopes of these lines are the same. So we have equivalent slopes. And remember, the slope is equal to Km divided by Vmax. So the fact that we have equivalent slopes tells us that the Km and Vmax are both changed by the same value. So overall, the ratio of Km over Vmax is the same. However, what we also notice here is that our y-intercept changes. So our y-intercept with the inhibitor is at about 0.0075, and our y-intercept without the inhibitor is around 0.003. So we have an increase in the y-intercept with an inhibitor around. Remember, the y-intercept is 1 over Vmax. So a larger value for the y-intercept corresponds to a smaller value for Vmax. So with the inhibitor, we have a smaller Vmax. And then that smaller Vmax then must mean the Km is smaller as well to keep the same slope. As it turns out, uncompetitive inhibition is really uncommon. But for those enzymes that do have naturally uncompetitive inhibitors, those inhibitors are incredibly potent, and they're very, very important in the regulatory function of the enzyme. In the next video, we're going to explore one more type of inhibitor that's a lot more common in everyday regulation of enzymes.